Welcome to the podcast.
Oh.
Young Hot Guys is a podcast brought to you by Shane Daniel Byrne.
Okay, well, and a few
and
more.
His friends.
And a few more.
And friends.
Yeah.
They're attractive.
They're very attractive.
Hot, loud.
And a little bit sad.
He was the best guy around.
Oh my, is it hot in here or what?
You're an attractive guy.
It's the fabulous Tony Cantwell.
I'm talking about Shane Daniel Byrne.
Idiot Sundermann!
Two, three.
I know you belong to Rira, but tonight you belong to Rira.
Oh, it's Young Hot Guys.
That wasn't that bad.
That was good.
Okay, off the cuff like that.
Our live gigs should just be us singing, and the people should be like aghast.
And we just
so disappointed.
We just keep opening new cans of re-raw. We go, all right, here's our other re-raw song.
This is re-raw, but it's funk pop from the 70s.
Yeah. Anyway, thanks for sponsoring the podcast, re-raw.
Thank you.
We don't cancel doing these podcasts because they're sponsored, so thank you for the accountability of cold hard cash. I don't forgive you. I feel like you. You fucked me over at Electric Picnic that year when I told you that joke and I asked you, was it funny? And you said yes. And
yeah.
I opened with it and it was awful. Because Billie Eilish had performed in Stradbally, County Leash, in Electric Picnic.
She'd rub the eye out of your head and come back for the Eilish.
Oh, that's good. That's better than what I had.
Yeah.
I said, so anyone see Billie Eilish on Friday? I tell you what, she should have called herself playing here. Stradbally, County Leash. County Leash.
And, you could have left it at Stradbillie Eilish.
Stradbillie Eilish. That would have been better. I know. And
sorry, guys,
like,
we're talking shop here.
No, but the,
but it was grossly unfunny.
I realized.
And I said it to you. And maybe you were like still like kind of buzzing because you were still like kind of nervous energy from just we're all walking around and you were like, that's good.
No, it made me laugh. But I don't think I was laughing at the joke. I was laughing at the thought of you telling that on stage. I think that's what was making me laugh.
Have a bit more clarity then next time.
I was like, yeah, you should say that because I will find it funny.
It was good. You chose the right person to seek advice from, though, because Killian is one of the top four comedians in Ireland. I think of, like, you know, Tommy Tiernan, Dylan Moore, Dave Kane, Killian Sundermann. You know what I mean? Everyone
yeah,
knows.
Yeah.
Well, I'm obviously not one of the top 10 because you're on the bloody last one laughing.
I am on last
and
one laughing.
And just heard Graham Norton describe Tony Cantwell as the making him laugh more than anything he's laughed in the last few years.
Yeah. Look,
how does that make you feel?
You can call me Phileas Fogg because my head is a big balloon now. His head wasn't a balloon, famously. But yeah, no, it feels good to have my best friend Graham Norton just kind of my peer.
Respect peer.
But it kind of means nothing. I mean, Graham's your friend. Like, I mean,
it's true.
You'd expect your friends to think.
Yeah, exactly. It's just like I'd probably say the same about him.
How was the glitzy party affair?
It was very fun. What was really weird was they did like a kind of red carpet thing, blue carpet because it was Amazon.
Yeah, that's what I text you. I was like, Amazon it's really Prime. Funny watching all of you. I was abroad and I was watching all the Instagrams of everyone on the carpet and I was like, this is hilarious. Like,
but it's also like so small.
I was laughing at Martin Angolo. Angolo only cares about doing jokes on the stage. He does not care about anything else.
Not at all.
And he is very good at doing his jokes on the stage. But I was like, the idea of Martin going, okay, I'll go talk on this carpet, really cracked
like
me
16
up.
People,
really cracked me up.
And they're like, you know, and then they'd be like, you know, so how did it feel? It was hard not laughing. And you'd have to, obviously, you owe them the courtesy of they're promoting it. So you have to be like, make it seem like this is the only time you've ever said this. Being like, oh my God, like it was so, you know. You have
do
to
you know almost me? Like, I'm always laughing.
I'm always laughing.
And everyone knows me.
Yeah.
This is normal.
And you
sure, I'm on the carpet. I'm Cate Blanchett.
But then you'd have weird ones like, they'd be like, okay, tell us a joke. And you'd be like, and then you'd do it or whatever. And then at the end, there was one where it was kind of like, then one of them was like, so look, how does it feel to be in a show, a comedy show, and none of the comedians are the shit ones?
Well, I don't know if you know my podcast, but I'm well worth used to working with shit comedians, so it was quite
so
a different
weird.
Experience.
Yeah,
I don't know if you've listened to the Young Hot Guys.
Name and shame. Who asked
No,
that?
I can't.
All right. Well,
but they were very nice. Well, they also asked me, did I say anything that I thought I would get cancelled for? And I said yes, for some reason. So it was a weird environment. And then the Amazon Prime people were like, there was a woman at the end and she's like, okay, Tony, this is the game. I'm going to ask you 20 questions and you need to give me your answer. If you've heard the question before, then you have to say so. And if that is the case, I have to eat something from my forfeit bucket. Do you understand the rules? And what? I'm like, no. Okay, let's go. And she asked me like 20 questions. And it was like, and she's like, and you honestly never heard of these, any of these questions before? And I was like, no.
I'd just be like, heard it before. And she's just,
yeah.
Next question.
Heard it before.
She's just gorging herself from her bucket. What's in this bucket?
Chicken bones.
Chicken bones, said to be. She's choking on a chicken bone.
Heard it, I said I've heard it before.
Yeah. Ass to ass.
Bit of Requiem for a Dream.
Requiem for a Dream reference. Everyone
knows
that, of
course. The references are crazy. Boys of a Certain Age, that was a very impactful moment. Requiem for a Dream. Anyway, now apparently he is a terrible bastard. Jared Leto.
Oh, yeah.
So I think let's avoid litigiousness.
Yeah.
But it was cool. And did you have your hair blow dried?
I had my hair blow dried.
I noticed that you didn't get asked what you were wearing. I was watching the Instagram videos as well. I thought I saw all the women were asked what they were wearing. I saw Tony was wearing actually quite a nice, interesting, not your classic kind of...
It was a double-breasted,
I'm just going to wear my tuxedo suit thing. You were wearing a nice thing and you weren't asked. Martin Angolo also was wearing something nice.
Martin also always looks great.
He does, yeah. He's a classic comedian. He dresses up in the suit and stuff. Mm.
We were given like a budget of like a couple of hundred euro to put into styling or whatever.
Did you get it for free and keep the money?
No, because... John was all like, no, invoice that. And actually, it's better if you go over so we get the money back quicker. Anyway, so I paid for my stylist, Katie Ruby, who got me like a lovely double-breasted suit. And we had a hairstylist come in. And my friend Andy from Indigo.
Well, can we do it like, can I? Because you never got the experience.
Oh, yeah, do it now. Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Tony, God, it's so great to see you here on the red carpet.
That's amazing. Okay, it's just so crazy we're here.
So listen, if you've heard this question before,
okay.
Just tell me and then I'll have to gorge on my own shit. So what are you wearing?
I've definitely heard that one before.
Tony, what is it you're wearing?
I'm wearing, what do you call it? It's vintage. Like, how do you say vintage?
You say vintage.
Okay, I'm wearing a vintage.
No, don't say a vintage. I'm wearing vintage and then the designer.
I'm wearing vintage Massimo Dati.
There you go.
Nice.
Double-breasted with a Burner Cool shacket, a Japanese brand of t-shirt, and Clark's shoes that I own myself.
Did your mom bring you up to Clark's and look around?
Yeah.
Did she press the toe on them shoes?
They'll do. Come on, get out.
And it's got a cool hologram on the side that when you press your thumb on it, there's a little divil appears.
Tony, do you know what? I had a pair of them.
Did you have them?
Years ago, where there was a fella in, the divil was in a cage, and then you press the thing and he was out of the cage. And then I went over to my cousin's house after school, played around, had a good time, changed my clothes. My Auntie Lucy, I went to get the shoes. She said, I gave them to Chernobyl. She gave my shoes to Chernobyl children.
To Chernobyl.
Oh no, I know. God. I don't begrudge the Chernobyl children the shoes, but this is, I mean, they're
lucky
gone.
Kid.
I don't, they had holograms on them anyway.
I mean, awful what happened to the kid. In Chernobyl, but he's got a great pair of shoes.
Have the scientists figured out whether or not, is it conclusive whether or not you run faster if you've got lights on your shoes?
No, that is true.
It's not, they figured that out.
I would probably run faster chasing a man with lights in his shoes.
Yeah, but then does that make the person with the, just, I remember the kids, when I was in school, the kids who had lights on their shoes, they
LA
said,
lights.
They said it made you run faster. And I don't, they did look like they moved like lightning.
I told my mother once when I was maybe 15, it was when camera phones were starting to come out. It wasn't like, not like what they are now. They were just like little tiny square pictures.
Yes.
And my mother, I had told her recently before this, I said, I never could ask for the shoes with lights. I was too embarrassed to ask for them. I didn't think you'd let me have them. And she was like, why did you not? And she was devastated. She's like, why not? And I was like, I just thought you'd be like, no, we're not having them. You're not getting them. You get these other ones. And she was devastated as a mother that I wasn't, that she didn't feel.
Approachable.
Then, within the following few weeks, I was talking with, she was like, why would I even want a picture on your mobile phone? And I was like, I think it's so cool. I think that's such a cool thing.
I don't know, Mom.
And then she listened to that then. And then, so she combined these two things together. And I came in from school, like second year or third year or something like that. And she bought me a new phone with that could take pictures.
Oh my God.
I thought she was going to get like a shoe with a phone sellotaped onto it and a camera.
No, it wasn't a shoe. It was actually a nicer thing than that.
Was it that Nokia that you could kind of take the bit of plastic off?
It was exactly that one that you could make your own covers.
And it had a 200. That's my first phone too.
And it had a torch on it.
Yes.
Yes. That was a really good one.
And the polyphonics of those ringtones, it was as close
was
to MP3.
Was that polyphonic then?
I mean, it was very like, before, you know, you had the old ringtones, you know, and all those ones, you know. But this was all like, you know,
I got a phone after that, which had some, when they went like beyond polyphonic and they were actually able to have like little songs on it. And they really went hard with the ringtones. And there was some really funny, just like, obviously, I don't know, like Motorola were paying people to make ringtones. And there was one we used to listen to all the time called the Ding Song. And it went ding 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 ding. And it was just a guy saying that.
Love
it. Oh man. Okay.
Let me tell you when I heard the Crazy Frog.
I'm gonna find it.
Of course, it was not called the Crazy Frog. It was called like Motorcycle Guy or whatever. You know, because I was like, here, listen to this guy's impression of a motorbike. The ding 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 ding. And we couldn't. I couldn't breathe. I couldn't move. It was the funniest thing I'd ever heard in my life. And then it was obviously co-opted by that little freak who was meant to come back again last year and didn't.
Yeah, there was the threat of him.
There was a big hype that he was going to be back. And I think he did, but, you know.
No, I can't. I'm looking on YouTube for the ding ding.
That's all right.
The ding ding ringtone. Ding dong ringtone.
You're going to get a doorbell.
I'm going to get a doorbell.
Do you remember on the old Nokias you could get like your own little background? It wasn't a photo, but like it was before photos. You could just get your own background. Like instead of having Nokia on it, it would just have like a picture.
Yeah,
you could go on like these. You'd look them up online and you could kind of like order one.
You get
a
Nike sign.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Remember all my mates had like just like lewd sexual images, like penetrative, like as their like background. Yeah, yeah. Or a man in a balaclava holding like a fucking Glock. When I say IRA was a good one. Yeah,
Anyway, was there any other gossip on the blue carpet then?
Sorry.
Stay on topic.
Well, we had a Q&A with Vogue Williams and she spoiled.
I heard this.
Which was funny.
I was in touch with
she
Emma.
She spoiled who won?
She spoiled someone's early departure from the series.
Did you not watch it?
We did, but she had watched an episode ahead.
Okay.
And it was like a third question, which was funny. She was actually quite good, but like I'd say cost a fortune.
How much Vogue I paid for that. Yeah, I was texting you about it and you were like, yeah, it was really great. And then I texted Emma Doran, enemy of the podcast, of course.
Yes, of course.
Enemy.
And she was able to give actual real gossip because she is a woman and women are better at that kind of thing.
I don't have any gossip. I'm kept out of it.
Some gossip is that me and Peter McGann were voice messaging each other absolutely furious that we weren't invited. So
really?
Well, I mean, I think, part of the show. We were part of the show.
Yeah.
In our own little way.
Yeah.
We tested it for the real comedians.
True.
I was invited.
True.
Yeah, of course. You were invited. Me and Peter not. They don't want the bad boys of comedy coming along, you know, because who knows what we're going to say.
Who knows what you're going to say.
You know, you put us on that red carpet.
You'd probably say
something
cute and twee in German.
Oh, yeah. I might just shake the whole system
up,
you know.
Peter would probably call out some sexual predators who haven't been named yet. You know?
A lot of them out there.
Who knows what you'd say? No, I don't have any gossip. I had a wonderful time. What happened? I tell you though, Deirdre O'Kane is just like, she's like something out of a Scorsese film. Like at the end, we were like, it was like an open bar. It was so weird because it was like Amazon Prime putting this thing on and it was kind of like, there was almost like English interpretations of Irishisms, you know?
Oh.
There was like twee grannies walking around kind of rinsing people as you came in.
Mrs. Brown's boys.
Very Mrs. Brown vibe. But like they were not discriminating. Like they were having to go with Graham Norton. And like, you know, he was like, they were like, and now have you eaten anything? You know, have you eaten anything? And he's like, no, I'm fine. Like he was responding to something so seriously. No, I'm grand. Thank you very much. And then there was like crisp sandwiches, but in rolls, in kind of like hard white, kind of hard soft rolls. You know what I mean? Kind of like a hard bite, but like a kind of soft roll.
Okay.
And salt and vinegar in there. In the crisp sandwich.
Okay.
Well, you can have that.
I don't know. I think you're...
We used to get lunch in fourth year. We used to get a buttered roll and buffalo hunky dories. That was the whole lunch.
That is a whole lunch. That is so filling.
Yeah.
So there was all that. But then afterwards, it was an open bar and it was great. And then afterwards, Deirdre came and was all like, okay, we're going to 37 Dawson Street. So we got in like a private car, went to 37 Dawson Street.
Wow.
She walked straight up to the bouncer who... I don't think she knew, but she had that rapport with. We're walking straight down. It was like fucking Ray Liotta in Goodfellas. We sit in the back area. We're given these gold wristbands. And there was like an open bar. And I was like, can I get a whiskey sour? And then everyone was like, what? I was like, it's very expensive. I was like, oh, sorry.
The rubbing shoulders with the top dogs.
It's rubbing shoulders.
What's it like being back with us, losers?
Yeah.
We're not Deirdre O'Kane.
Yeah. No, you're not at all.
Deirdre O'Kane does both, though. She does her works on her material around the clubs. She does that. Sits on the dirty stairs. Goes, does her little gigs.
She does.
She does.
Yeah, I saw her the day after she'd done the Olympia to like over 1,000 people, and she was doing cherry comedy with me. And I was like, what are you doing here? And she's like, yeah, I know, you're back here and you know, back in the shit or whatever. A cherry comedy, great comedy club.
She is funny when she does, though, because she has her glasses on and off like a man. Because she's reading new jokes and she's reading off her notes. And she's like, right, we'll try this. And then she puts on the glasses and takes them off like a man looking at a brochure for holidays. And it's just really...
She looks like a woman in her 30s, but she holds a phone like that far away.
Yes, like, that's
like, what? That's what gives her away. It's like, you know, when they do the kind of like de-aging in like The Irishman. But then you see like Robert De Niro try and kick someone's head in. And he's all like, you know, he's not quite, you know, you can tell that this is, that's the kind of vibe, you know.
Speaking of holidays, you just got back from your holiday.
I'm just back from very tanned. Am I tanned?
Not really.
I'm tanned than other people on the holiday. It was a group holiday. I tell you, it was highs and lows.
Really?
Oh.
Well, because I had to go to the doctor and because my throat was swollen. And I went to the doctor and then they gave me antibiotics in the butt. Not in the butthole.
Okay.
Just an injection. Wow. And then the antibiotics made me sick. So I had a whole night getting sick.
Oh, God.
And how do you say shitting yourself?
Oh, my God.
So that was terrible. So then I went back to the doctor again. Then they gave me one of those, like, you know those injections people get on a plane when they're vomiting?
Mm-hmm.
I got one of them. Okay. And it just makes it stop. I don't know what's in that.
Oh, my God.
It was kind of magic. Wow. But then I had to take a cocktail of drugs all day. So, and I couldn't drink
up
anymore. So I was like, I took four butt injections.
Mm-hmm.
And then I had to take.
And you were only supposed to get one, but you just begged for more.
I was like, what about? She was like, okay, so you should be fine now. The throat looks good. And I was like, what about another butt injection?
Coming back every day.
I've never met a man.
Do you have
loves
a butt injection for my friend as well, please?
I feel like they love butt injections in Spain because I got one in Spain before.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And I got bitten by bed bugs and I was allergico. And then they gave me another injection in the butt there.
Really?
They love giving injections in the butt.
I think
over
they're just a little bit less kind of, you know, puritanical.
I tell you what they do. What they lash out. They don't, when they get your prescription, they lash out. Not like the pharmacies here. I tell you, we attacked pharmacies in this podcast before. I don't know if that ever made it to air. But the pharmacies are very self-important over in Ireland now. Over in Spain, you go into the pharmacy and you're like, hi, yeah, I dropped my prescription last week as they failed. And they're like, it's not ready. you idiot.
Yeah.
Whereas then in Spain, they just give you the whole box.
Mm.
It's like, yeah, whatever, take the whole box.
Yeah.
Yeah, do you want that? Yeah. And it's like, must take 2 tablets only. And they're like, here's 40. They just do it. So I was like, yeah, viva España.
Mm.
I've got a cut on my cheek. Yeah, okay, you're going to take down your pants.
First, the butt injection.
Put it in your bone.
There was a lot of COVID though. We're in Gran Canaria and there's a lot of COVID. They have to do, I did COVID test on 2 of the visits because she was like, we'll just do a test because I know you test yesterday, but a lot of time this week, people come here. They have a COVID. So I was like, okay, right.
Oh,
so,
nice.
But I didn't have the COVID.
Yeah.
Do you speak any Spanish?
No.
That's very good.
You almost tried to say a few words.
I was going
to
say, I was going to say like, oh, piquito.
Oh, piquito.
No, I don't have
a Chico Latino or?
Show me where I need to go.
Find my love.
My dolce vita.
By Jerry Halliwell.
Jerry Halliwell.
In
a weird,
Spice Girls.
A weird
yes,
move
no,
that she
Spice
did.
Girls.
Weird move.
Why was she doing that Spanish thing?
I think she was trying to lose her gingerness.
She's a Tory now.
Oh, yeah.
Big Tory.
She's not
Tory.
A Tory. Did you not see her big butcher's apron dress?
Yes.
I actually couldn't think of the word Union Jack. And
butcher's apron is
butcher's
also
apron
correct.
Came butcher's apron's to my head job. Faster.
I thought it was amazing how you just came up with them.
Yeah, great job. What else? What else did you do?
We went to the beach. We could not swim at the nudie beach. That was upsetting.
Why not?
Because
Why?
The current was too currenty. So, and it's like, it's all well and good being at nudie beach, but if you can't swim at a beach, what's the point?
And do you respect the sea?
You must respect the sea.
Really?
And the lifeguards were beeping their horns at people who were like paddling. They were like, get out of that water. They were really,
really
serious about it. Yeah, it was very serious.
Red and did the horns go?
Wow.
Did they play a Mexican tune in Gran Canaria?
Gran Canaria is absolutely like... fake. I posted up being in Gran Canaria and like it's like a gay people's place, right? Mm. Gay people and retired people love it, right? Mm. So retired from Germany, Scandinavia, UK, and Ireland. Like it's not a real place.
No, it's not.
It's a cartoon.
Did you see any old bronze queens?
I saw them, bronzed queens. I saw so many bronzed boobies.
Ah!
Just like free in the wind.
Yeah.
I was like, yeah, let those girls swing.
But they're not the, swing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Not like, you know, they're the, you know, I often find the reality of nudie beaches are not as sexy as the idea of nudie beaches.
No, yeah.
No, it's all very business, really. Mm. Mm. And like the men, the gay nudie beach, when do your balls become so pendulous?
Mm.
What decade is that? Like there are men there and they're like, and they're like bending over to pick up their sun cream or whatever. And
something
it's like
swings and hits you in the face.
They're dragging. It's like you leave your footprints on the beach. They also have a little trail from their balls. Like it is on.
Was a raptor?
Yeah.
You're looking at the beach, yeah, going, "Oh my God, is there snakes on this beach?
Yeah.
What is that trail?
Oh, no, it's old man balls.
Snakes. The snake followed the man for about 2 miles.
Unbelievable.
Couple of fag butts here.
Unbelievable. I'm going to get mine taken up when I'm that age.
Well, they had those boxers. You know, the old boxers that have, like, you know, no testicular support. I think we have had bras for a while that I think we'll have a few more years on.
Bra boxers.
I also will get them probably done. I've already had my balls operated on. I'll have a, but I wouldn't mind it happening again.
Just a nip tuck. Get them taken up.
Get them taken up a little bit.
Yeah. No wrinkles.
I heard the other day you can only have...
They don't tighten the way they used to.
Get mine Botoxed.
You know, like with a good boner. Remember like a 17-year-old boner?
Don't say that.
And they would like become... And I'm not old, but like when I was 17, it would almost. Do I only have one ball now? This scrotum has now gotten fucking. You know, but not so much anymore.
Mm, yeah. No, that's true. Yeah.
Does yours? You don't want to talk about it?
I don't want to talk about 17-year-olds' boners. No.
When you were 17, and you had like a boner, I'm not talking about.
Oh my God.
What's the issue here?
When the lifeguard came up to you, did he say, "The sea is like barn black because of current, because of so many currents"?
Oh my God.
No,
oh
no,
my God,
that's
I'm
not it.
I'm going to black out now.
Anyway, okay.
I'm hearing a ringing in my ears.
So no, you know, we all have to do our bit. Yeah, that's a joke. Let's keep going.
You
let's go.
Call the sea.
Let's move on.
It's the sea.
The sea is in barn black.
Where's that from?
What is that?
The sea is like a barn black.
The vampire lifeguard.
Porque there's so many colors.
It was a lady lifeguard.
Okay.
Pamela Anderson.
Yeah, it was kind of like Pamela Anderson, well, except in a Range Rover.
Mm.
Do you know, I'm not a sun worshipper, though. I don't...
Oh, me neither.
I don't really get it.
I worship the shade.
I worship the night. But I don't really get it. Like, oh, I'm going to lay out now. I'm just going to lay out.
I don't like being that warm. I don't like sweating.
Too hot.
I don't like feeling the sensation of sweat. I don't like a little dribbly tickle down my armpit at all.
Right.
Do you not like a nice heat, like, though? I can't stand the cold, especially in a house.
Is everything okay on this podcast?
Yeah, everything's
fine. I'm just returned from abroad. I don't know.
Yeah, you're back from abroad.
I'm back from abroad. I was overseas.
Shane feels like this is a dream.
I was overseas. I do feel a bit like this is a dream because I was just abroad yesterday.
You were abroad.
You just got in so late.
And I was in, you're in the Grand Canaries. You're in the continent of Africa, but they're like, it's Spain. It's
it's
no,
wild.
It is not. Mm-hmm. And there is nothing. And it's like, welcome. And then I learned that there was a Canaries freedom movement who wanted to make the Canaries independent, and they did a bomb and everything, but they stopped then.
Did they?
Yeah, they stopped then after that. They were like, oh, sorry.
I'm just picturing like hot bronzed terrorists and budgie smugglers.
Yeah.
But it's probably really grim.
We are the Canaries.
Take down your pants.
Sorry, you're just in from the Canaries.
Yeah.
Where are our laser lights? Where's our laser pointers?
Oh, I know.
Where's our laser pointers?
Where's your coral necklace?
Where's our coral necklace?
I got my hair braided. no, I was thinking of
trying
to do that.
Did you not see anything you could have brought back?
Yeah, I did. I bought a load of crap while I was there. But I meant to buy like something like silly, like office. I'm actually sad you said that because I wanted to do some kind of joke. I was like, I'm just back from holidays. Look what I got. And then tell you all about the...
Yeah.
But I'm very low energy and I was late this morning. So I don't know. I'm in crisis. I mean...
Yeah.
Are you?
No, I'm not.
It's
just
a weird thing because you're kind of just back from your Hollybops. And I know you were kind of waiting. I mean, the new year was pretty much going to start the day after your Hollybops.
Which is
and
now.
You haven't really had a chance to even think about what your life is because you came from the flight pretty much to bed.
In the bloody traffic.
And in the traffic and then you're here.
It's
kind of hard to be like, what do we want?
Because we did the podcast very early this morning because I'm also going on my holidays.
Mm-hmm.
I was getting a train at the same time as the commuters.
Ugh.
Yeah, and it was so... I was sitting there... And, you know, I had my headphones in and I was just looking at all the other people looking out the window. And, you know, something happens to you when you're listening to like morning music and you're looking out the window. And I was just like sitting in it like I was in a film. And I was like, these guys don't realize I'm not actually a commuter. I'm different from all of them.
I'm kind of freelance.
Just like, you know, like Dido. And, and I'm imagining the camera zooming out and it's like, that's me. I just work a regular 9 to 5. I'm just a regular guy. But actually at nighttime, I'm a totally different person. And I want to thank you. My name's Killian. I'm a stand-up comedian. Giving me the best day of my life.
What are we meant to feel watching this film? Are we happy?
I don't know.
For
it's
you?
Just like, I think when I'm on, I don't know what it is about getting a morning commuter train and I see people with their briefcases and I'm like, I'm different from you guys. Mm-hmm. And then I kind of think that it's all about me. And I don't think in any other moment than when I'm on a train and I'm sitting around loads of people just living their lives, I never feel more like the world, I'm the only person in the world and it's all about me or something, or like it's a film and I'm in it. You know, when you're just kind of like tucking your hair that doesn't exist behind your ear, just going like, looking out the window going like, but everything is kind of, everyone's looking at me right now.
I'd say a relatable thing of that is also when, like, for people who aren't comedians, would be like when you've kind of done a bit of a rollover and you're heading home and you happen to be in like the, you haven't slept, but you're on that, you're in there in, like in college, you're in the kind of morning rush traffic.
Yeah.
But you're kind of like, I'm still drunk. That's kind of what it's like.
I think that is dark. That's dark. Always get a cab home, even if you stayed up till 11 the next morning.
Really?
Don't get on the public transport. It's just so dark.
No.
Do you not find that? I find that like, I got the bus home. I was up all night at a party in town. I got the bus home and I was like, what am I doing here? Mm. You were like, none of these people on the train know that I'm Deirdre O'Kane. I'm like, none of these people know that I'm a disgusting pig. But then I was like, maybe they do know. It's like that meme, look at me.
Like that meme where they're like, you know, none of these people know. They're like, we literally know. Everyone on the bus is like, oh, we know.
We know. Disgusting.
You
disgusting.
Smell of alcohol.
You smell like pig. Party. No, I think you should always get the cab home. It's not, don't put yourself because then... thing. Anyway, my party days are behind me, I think.
Oh,
in many,
yeah,
in many ways.
Absolutely aren't.
In many ways.
I'm more thinking of when you put music in, though, and you kind of just think you're in a film and a TV show and kind of get really dramatic. And I get very swept up in that, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes I just literally imagine I'm in, like, Bicycle Thieves and, like, someone's stolen my bike and I have to provide for my little boy and my wife and it's post-war Italy and I'm listening to, like, you know,
I thought
Ennio
you were
Morricone.
Be the child.
I was the little child. I'm like, my dad has lost his bike and I have to help him.
The ladder and everything.
Yeah, that
do you,
bit.
Do you remember when you had like a proper job, how many things you would actually do in a day compared to how many things you do in a day now? Because I would think if I was actually, I had to go into like a real job again and do the commute and like get in there at 9 and sit there to 5, like if they were like, can you do that and can you get that done today? I'd be like, well, that's too much. Look, bro, I only do 3 things a day. That's kind of my...
Yeah, yeah.
3 things max, including phone calls. Right?
They're all so done by 11. Of,
you know? Like, do you remember the amount of shit you'd have to do in a day?
Yeah.
And how, like, not Dawson you'd have to do.
You'd have to do them.
You'd have to do all the
especially
things.
Especially pre-COVID.
Yes.
There's not that many people commuting stuff. Now, though. I was on the train with the regular people. I've seen them.
They were on the bloody road. They were on the bloody road.
And I felt bad. I felt like a mug being on the road. I mean, a single person in a car. Gross. Sorry, Killian. I know you love the environment.
I do, yeah.
I think there's probably way worse ways that you're affecting the environment. It's not on us anyway. No, hang on. I can't be like that. No, be the change you want to see in the world. But I mean, can we not hold the companies really feet over the fire a bit harder rather than this level of guilt?
Yeah, and that shower in Dáil Éireann. That shower in Dáil Éireann. Hunter Biden's laptop.
Whoa. This guy's speaking the truth over here.
Yeah, well, I have Hunter Biden's laptop. Let me tell you, I have it downloaded. And there is going to be Roderick O'Gorman. There is going to be trouble for Roderick O'Gorman.
I but there used to be this guy in the local pub near my parents' house who it was like, you know, this is like in 2008 or something like that. He was this mad old man, but he was like telling me, he was like, I'm downloading the internet.
Oh.
He's like, one day the internet's going to go. And I'm downloading it. I've got loads of hard drives at my house. And one day it's going to go. And they're going to be like, oh no, we need to bring the internet back. I'm going to sell it to them. Millions. Billions.
And this was his
the
idea.
Only person to he was going to download the only person to download the entire... I mean, I don't know how much file size, but I'm imagining he just like his whole house was kind of like insulated with hard drives, just terabytes.
In a way, he invented cloud storage.
In a way, yeah.
In a way,
maybe
yeah.
He did. Who knows? He could be a billionaire now.
A guy I know has a terabyte of porn.
A terabyte of porn?
Mm. A terabyte. A terabyte. Maybe more terabytes.
That's too much.
Isn't it?
Is his name Peter McGann?
I can't say. I can't say. Really, I've never talked about porn with Peter.
But that's too much.
It is too much.
That's weird.
How would you get through it?
Multiple screens. Probably, he's probably double, quadruple screen. You know, he's probably like Tom Cruise in Minority Report.
Like a sports bar in America, just screens all over.
That would be... Would you go?
Well, you see...
I'd say they have the that, like, there's underground. Like
an Amsterdam.
I worked in a sports bar, and the way it is people come in and they want to watch... Like, I want to see the Miami Flamin' Grill House on this TV. And I want to see the Texas, you know, flip the cup, dippers on this screen. And they really, like, come in and they want to sit here and they want to have their team on this. Because all the games happen at the same time. So I imagine if you have some sort of, you know, porn thing, it's like, I want to have Two Girls, One Cup over here.
Me
and my family are sitting here and we want Two Girls, One Cup over here.
Apparently that was real to be fake. Two Girls, One Cup.
Was it?
Yeah, the consumption was
Can
fake.
We rebunk?
I'm glad that's been debunked. That's because it's kind of like, I couldn't handle that.
I vividly remember watching it with girls and everything.
Wow.
We all screamed. It was great.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's been debunked. It's not what you think, but very effective for sure.
There was a great sketch. One of the first kind of comedy sketches I saw. I think it was like College Humor or something like that. Do you remember them?
Yeah, they were great.
They were really good. They were kind of set up sketch on the internet. But it was just the guy, the producer, talking to the girls before Two Girls, One Cup.
This is Amy Schumer.
Did
she steal it?
I don't know, but it was... I mean, I saw this in...
Boot, Amy Schumer, boot.
Wait, can I tell the sketch?
You can tell the sketch,
or am I supporting? I don't know if I want to say what the sketch is now because I don't want to support genocide.
It's very funny, but you're not supporting the Zionist Amy Schumer.
Well, it's just the producer beforehand just going up to them and going like, yeah, just your regular lesbian scene. You guys are cool with that? And they're like, yeah, cool. That sounds good. And he's like, also just, yeah, your simple stuff, you know, a bit of back and forth. You guys kissing, that's cool. They're like, yeah, that's cool. Cool, yeah, chill, take a shit in a cup and then you kind of like eat the cup or whatever. Okay, so we'll start you. They're like, what? He's like, yeah, just your regular kind of, you guys are kissing a bit and then just a shit in a cup and then you're going to eat it or whatever. Put it in your mouth. Is that cool? You cool with you guys? I don't know. I haven't seen the video, so I don't actually know what happens in it, but I imagine that's what happens.
Did you never see Two Girls, One Cup?
No.
This is like saying
I haven't seen The Godfather. It's like...
I haven't seen The Godfather, but I have seen Two Girls, One Cup.
Yeah.
And I have seen LemonParty.org.
Okay, so you've seen two of the three greatest films. I love Lemon Party. I find Lemon Party super cute.
I think it just got added to the Criterion Collection.
Lemon Party.
Yeah.
Then you're there in the closet. Oh, I gotta get Lemon Party. We saw this. I don't know if you've seen this. A bunch of old men sucking each other off. It's
that was the one which, when you typed it in, the browser would pop up, but for some reason they had it programmed that it would jump around.
Yeah, so you couldn't click off.
You'd try click it and it would jump away. You'd be like, you know, when you get flustered in those situations, you're just trying to click it.
And it just sounds so cute. Lemon Party.
It did also have a funny whistling in the background, like...
Yeah, that was pretty loud.
Something like that.
So it kind of like fill up your speakers. It was basically like the put that on so that this is something that is so abrasive and so, you know,
crazy. Do you know
crazy.
The worst one of those that I've ever heard?
What?
Some person, this is in college, someone, do you know the, when you open your laptop up or something like that and it goes, dun, 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 or something like that, if you don't have earphones in. Someone reprogrammed the noise of that on someone else's laptop in DIT. It was called DIT back then. It's TUD now. They reprogrammed it to be like that orgasm noise.
Yeah.
That one. Yeah. And it was before that noise was ubiquitous and people could recognize it.
Mm.
So it was just sounded like, and they, so the guy opened his laptop in the library and it just went big orgasm noise. Oh my God.
If I heard that, I'd be like, what a fucking legend. This guy must be getting reams of... Flange.
That would kill me.
You know?
Another one that happened far less is my friend was studying in college and he was just watching a play in the library because he had to do some research on it. And then he was like going to take a break. So he took his earphones out and he realized he had not inserted the earphone jack properly and the entire play had just been playing at full volume in the middle of the library. And he just turned to the person next to him and he's like, has that been playing the whole time? And they were like, yeah. He's like, why didn't you tell me?
Oh my God.
That doesn't happen anymore. Or if you pull your earphones out or any of that stuff doesn't happen anymore. The young people don't know.
No, because the if a Bluetooth loses a connection, it just goes on pause.
It goes on pause now. They have that set up.
They have that set up.
Guys, I'm about to go to America.
Yes.
Yes.
And I'm going through customs. Last time we went through customs, they took us to the back room and they grilled us. And the only reason we managed to get on our plane was because the plane was delayed. So I'm nervous. We're going to get there hours and hours before, but I really need to, I need some help getting through. What can you guys ask me some questions or kind of just help guide me through? I'm looking for
finish the sentence.
Yeah.
Allah.
You are a ba. Oh, you're bad. Or not bad, but no, just, I respect all of
it. Yeah.
Actually, we were looking for that's a la carte. What they'll ask. We were looking for a la carte.
A la carte for the lounge.
A la carte for
the lounge. You're not even in customs yet. This is just the Aer Lingus lounge.
I've never been to America, so I'll just, I don't know what they ask in there. So they're like, you ever caught a gator?
Yes. No. No. No.
You lily-livered son of a bitch.
Yes. Yes.
Looks good.
Am I doing well?
You ever been on a hovercraft?
Yes.
Let's ask you some.
When we were the kind of questions they asked. First of all, we did J1s, you know, and that's why they were grilling us because of our J1s, you know. Mm-hmm. We hadn't done anything wrong, which is what you have to keep reminding yourself of, because when they take you aside, they find things very suspicious for like no reason, and my letter for my J1 was sent from an office in Maine. They were because that's where the people, CIE, who are the organization, it's an office in Maine. I was flying to New York. So the guy behind the desk was like, so you're going to New York? And I was like, yeah. And he's like, this letter's from Maine. And I was like, yeah. And he went, that's a different state. And I was like, oh yeah, yeah, it is. But you're saying this as if suddenly, like, even though I know that's not bad, that makes no sense why it's wrong. I was sitting there going, oh my God, it's a different state. Oh, Jesus Christ, I'm fucked. Yeah. I'm going down. So they kind of like, they really, it's really arbitrary the reason. Like Anna was getting grilled, like proper, taken to the back room and they were grilling her. And he was like, what were you doing? What were you doing while you were in America? What were you doing? And she was like, I don't know. I was just like, you know, doing an internship and all this kind of stuff. And he's like, but what were you doing? You were there for a long time. Like, what were you doing? And he was like, for ages and ages, our flights, like, we think we've missed our flight and stuff like that. And then Anna just goes, I don't know, like, my mom visited me. And he's like, your mom visited you? She was like, yeah. He's like, what did you guys do? And she's like, we just went to, like, you know, the East Village and we kind of cut some bagels. And he's like, oh my God. Oh yeah, that sounds, sure, that's, well, welcome. And he's like stamping her past and going, welcome to America. I don't know. He liked that her mom visited. Something
what
about
they,
that.
What do they want?
What do they want? All right, here's one for you, right?
Is there American people in the airport in Dublin?
Yeah, they do the customs in Ireland because so many Irish people go. So they have the customs there. So if you don't get in, you can just get a taxi home. But that, some people think that makes them more likely to say no to you because they know that they're not sending you all the way across the Atlantic.
All right, here's one.
Okay.
Killian.
Yeah.
Can you describe a challenging project that you worked on and how you handled it?
Yes, I distinctly remember when the project being me trying to bring sort of a Second Amendment kind of situation to Ireland, and just kind of like, you know, believing in, you know, some people were kind of freedom of speech and all that. And I was really like, yeah, I thought that was, I speak my mind and I respect other religions except Islamic ones.
Sorry, I do want to say, when I said finish the sentence Allah, I obviously do not believe that all Muslim people are, you know what I mean? I just feel like that's what they're looking
for. You were doing the character of I don't think that
needs
to be explained.
Yeah, okay, just to be sure.
Okay, so would you let me in?
Yeah, I suppose. I mean, I'd let everyone in, you know?
Why not?
I mean, it's all arbitrary, these whole...
Yeah, I just want to say I'm equally indifferent to all religions because they're all wrong.
Good point.
So,
wait, even Catholicism?
Wrong.
No, it's not.
Yes, it is. They're all wrong. There is nothing. And ultimately, there is nothing. We are alone. And that's okay.
The way you started saying that was like almost like you were a morning TV you know, there is nothing. And coming up on the show...
Now, is there anything at all? Well, theism has taken a knock over the last number of years, with a lot of people walking away from organized religions. Where are they going? Now, our next guest, Tony Cantwell, will tell us about what he's been doing in the absence of devoting himself to faith or worshipping a leader of sorts. Tony, what have you been doing and why did you get so wet doing it?
I look at the primal animals. I look at kind of becoming an animal, becoming animalistic. I've gotten really out of this whole bipedal kind of thing. Mm. And I'm kind of quadruped now, climbing on my hands and knees.
And quadruped, that's on hands and knees, is
that's
it?
Hands and feet. And I'm kind of getting into my kind of ape movement stuff. Right now I've been working with a movement coach who's been really helping me with that. He says he can really make the most of my very long arms. I've been eating what I find.
You do have long apish arms.
I do have long apish arms.
So you're lucky in that regard.
I'm lucky in that regard. I've been climbing trees. I'm actually very good at climbing trees. I've just been scavenging. I've been getting very sick. I've been eating a lot of berries and kind of mushrooms and things that I find in the ground. But I have felt more in tune with the truth that it's all bullshit and nothing is real.
Well, that's great. Nothing is real. Mm. It's real.
Blue Monday, but... should it be blue all the time? Recent studies have shown that there is no God and everyone should really, I mean, when you look at it, there's no meaning to anything at all. And we should just kind of accept that and then maybe hopefully move on with our lives. But, you know, if we don't, it doesn't really matter.
And is that not, I sometimes think, is that not all the more reason to be nice to each other? Yeah. The deep loneliness and the vast expanse of this ever expanding infinite universe, always growing, will never reach the edge of it. Truly, truly lonely existence. Mm. Not all the more reason to be kind to each other, friendship, you know, to your fellow man. Or do we go the nihilist route and there is no laws?
You're not wrong.
Do we kill indiscriminately?
You know, the infinite expanse of the internet, of the internet and also of the universe, you know, that kind of would fill me more with sort of this expanding sort of feeling of dread and that sort of like, you know, nothing really matters and that way, you know, that's sort of the vibe.
You know, who's to stop me cutting some bitch up, you know?
Yeah, that's what I think.
Who's to stop me taking out a Glock and filling up Tony here with lead top to bottom? Oh, who's to stop me? Well, who says that's right or wrong?
I'm actually a Terminator, so we can. I'm actually a Terminator, so.
God, all right. God, well, a good God would tell you that's wrong.
Are you there, God? It's me, Shane. Can you hear me? I'm going to fucking kill and maim anyone I want because I feel so desperately alone because capitalism has left me empty inside. Are you there, God? Are you listening to that? Show us, do something. What are you doing for us lately, God? Where's the magic? Do you ever notice that? Do you ever notice that? Oh, years ago, oh, Deuteronomy and Methuselah did this. Where's the magic now, God?
It's true.
And now, after the break, we'll be talking to Anna Geary about being an athlete and pregnancy and all the rest. You're alone and life is getting lonely. Yeah. You can always go downtown.
I'm going to be on tour. Go to my link tree. Or go to my Instagram and click on a little link and you'll see all the lovely little dates there. I hope it'll come to a town near you. Still to be announced, since I don't have a Galway date and I don't have a London date or a Belfast date, but they're going to happen, and I swear. But I'm going to be coming to Dublin and Wicklow and Cork and Limerick and Dundalk and Blanchardstown and Holt and somewhere else as well.
I'm going to loads of places as well, and they're all over Ireland. But I'm also going to London on the 27th of this month. So if you please buy tickets, maybe it's 28th actually. Oh shit! Check my
Queen of England.
Yes, I'm going over to replace the Queen. well, pretty weird choice, but I'll take it.
They pick with someone at random nowadays.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're in Soho.
Soho.
How's your book coming along?
It's good. Maybe I'm going insane. I'm not going to give you a word count because the people who have asked me to write this, the same people who published Joyce, are probably, they might listen to this and I don't want to get in trouble, but let's just say I'm basically done.
Great.
It's driving me insane. I'm going a bit mad, but
he's
writing
on a typewriter and he has to count the words manually.
That's insane.
So it's crazy.
Yeah, you shouldn't do that.
My parents do it for me. They count.
Oh, great.
Can I ask you a bit of inside baseball question?
Yes.
Of like, what is actually your process for getting stuck into writing something? There might be people here who have to like sit down and do some deep work. Like, how do you find you're able to get into the best flow in what kind of setting?
Public libraries
Yeah.
are the best place to write. Mm-hmm. Because
First of all, you are self-aware of the screen that you are working on. Mm. Because it's not a private little screen. Mm. Yeah, you can't. Yeah, you can't. It's not like your little laptop, which you can
cannot wank.
You can shroud around. A public library, everyone can see what you're doing. So I have the Google Docs open and I am typing because I'm aware of people around me. Mm-hmm. And then once you start tapping away, it starts going. But start action precedes motivation. You have to start before you get motivated, and then the motivation comes. And sometimes you start writing and it feels like there's nothing coming. And you're like wringing a dry towel and nothing's coming out. Just get up and go for a walk and then come back to it.
Okay.
I say that, but I'm really banging my head off a keyboard going, this is not a book. This is barely a monograph.
Maybe it's so much more than a book.
Imagine it fucking blows up. Imagine it's like, look, like there's this Irish book. Like they're like Drew Barrymore's talking about it. Like, God. This book, you got to read it. It's about fucking bushes and shit.
If that I would be happy at so much less than that. Like the level of success for me in this is just so, the bar is so low.
Can't wait to see it in the East.
But anyway, I'll maybe talk more about what the subject matter and stuff.
Will it be up by Christmas?
No. Oh yeah, this Christmas. Yeah, it will be. Sorry, I thought, is it about Christmas?
No.
I'm like, no, that would be so insane.
Is it about Christmas? That'd be a weird question.
Can I say, because you guys, tour, yeah. No tour, but... Bureau de Change tickets, please go to that. And also, if you want to support this podcast, this very podcast, you can. And there's another, people are always messaging going, oh, every Thursday I have to wait for the thing, it's only once a week. We do another episode every week.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it is better than this one. Can you believe that? People are often like, I listen to the bonus ones, and I'm like, that's better. There's a this is incredible, obviously, but the bonus is a little bit wilder, a little bit looser, and it's really like a peek behind the curtain. It feels like a warm embrace. It feels like you're at a poker table with your friends, and
except your pants are off.
Yeah, it's wild.
Yeah, your pants are off. There's a Spanish man injecting you, and it's great. So be a young.
It's kind of like being in a lad chat. Like you see some awful shit where they're sharing images, crazy shit, because it's like a real fucking laddie kind of fucking lad chat kind of group.
I think it's welcoming for all.
It's welcoming, but like it's fucking men. Like
no, it's
mad.
I would it's welcoming for all genders. I would say.
Yeah. But
mainly fucking lads, right?
Yeah.
Lads, yeah.
Exactly.
Anyway, young hug guys, thank you. Bye.
I love you, bye.
They're attractive.
I got very attractive.
Hot and loud.
And a little bit sad.
He was the best guy around.
Oh my, is it hot in here or what?
You're an attractive guy.
It's the fabulous Tony Cantwell.
I'm talking about Shane Daniel Byrne.
Idiots on the ball!
Ooh.